Worry is also happiness. All secrets are in the now. All pretense is true. All lies are true. All pretense is true. We've shifted gears here to an even higher understanding. This is ultimately what the teachers are pointing to. And I'm saying, I love this. So this is the nervousness, like, oh, do we dare take this rehabilitative step? I was thinking of that Don't Worry, Be Happy song. Don't worry, be happy. And I said, wait a minute. Worry is also happiness. I don't need to try to not worry. Worry is also happiness. And then right away I said, that's the non-dual. Yeah, wonderful. So, good morning. Welcome to the video. Welcome to the next phase of rehabilitation. I'm simply inviting everyone into rehabilitation from the dreadful disease of dualistic belief. Dreadful disease. And it's the great rehabilitation. It's the great addiction that we have. All addictions are actually just offshoots of this one addiction, the belief in duality, good and bad, absurdity, worry and happiness, secrets and openness, lies and truth, pretense and non-pretense. It's all dualistic. All pretense is true. All lies are true. From the ultimate viewpoint, what can leave truth? What can leave itself? What can leave intrinsic spaciousness? So everything is inherently in intrinsic spaciousness. Lies are in intrinsic spaciousness, pretense. So the truth is freedom. So all lies are free, meaning they're true, they're in truth, the truth of freedom. All lies are free. All lies are true. All pretense is true. Everything is true. What we do is we compound. What we're trying to do, what our ambition is trying to do. The last video I says, don't be a scapegoat for failed ambition. What is our ambition? Our ambition is to keep compounding pretense and thinking that in the compoundment of it, and this world is an example of this attempt to compound it, that somehow some pretense will not be true. And the realization is that nothing's ever happened here in that regard. All pretense is still entirely true. The idea that something is being compounded is simply that there's no actual compoundment has ever taken place. All is happiness. Even yoga girls are happiness. Even yoga girls are true. I just let one in that we got to an intersection there. This yoga girl with her aviator sunglasses and a Range Rover. And she's like, you know, I am here. The queen is here. And we got to the intersection at the same time. She was on the right. Well, I got there a little earlier, but she's on the right, wanting to turn right. And I didn't care who it was. I just saw a car coming. And I said, well, go ahead. Go ahead. I waved, go ahead. And then she makes a beeline for the local gym to get her yoga girl empowerment workout on. That's fine. Even yoga girls are true. Even yoga girls are happiness. Even the intense ambition of a compoundment is happiness. Let's see. So. This is what the teachings are pointing us to. The non-dual perspective. So I had this dialogue, inner dialogue this morning with the seeker and the self. I just allowed this dialogue to take place, and it went well. The seeker calmed down and listened, and then when it started to hear this, you know, even pretense is true. All secrets are also in the now. All secrets are now. All lies are now. All pretense is now. The seeker said, I like that. Now the seeker was struggling and didn't put up the video of don't be a scapegoat for failed ambition. I woke up in the morning, I said, hey, you didn't put the video up. What's going on? Oh yeah, I was busy doing other stuff, as slideshows. I said, yeah, but what about the video? I guess I better put that up. And then the seeker says, I'm doomed. If I put that up, I am doomed. I said, even doom is now. All doom is now. All doom is also happiness. So the seeker put the video up. And then the seeker says, okay, maybe I'm doomed. Well, maybe not. I don't know. We'll just have to see. Certainly. That's a video that duality is just going to go, you know. Oh, my God. I'll never be invited to be a spokesman for the goddess again, you know. It's okay. I'm a spokesman for rehab from the goddess. Rehab from duality. Never be a spokesman for duality and all the perks. But, of course, in rehab, we get the perk of a reduced intensity zone. Real nice place. You know, rehab, drug rehabs, these various rehabs for addictions. They're usually in a very beautiful setting, right? The rehab house. You pay a lot for them. We don't have to pay anything for the reduced intensity zone. Our willingness is the payment. It's been an extraordinarily interesting morning. I wish you could be in my shoes. I'll try to give you at least some sort of feel for that. It's as if a whole new panorama is opening up. And good. I've been working towards it. So I'm like a kid with a new toy. It's like a bicycle. What is this? It's like, wow. You know, you get some new toy that you haven't seen before, and you're like, this is really interesting. What could you do with this? I've been working on balancing on like this foam roller. It's really, really good exercise for balancing. And I discovered something. After all these years, who says they can't teach old dogs new tricks? I've been trying to discover the key to balance my whole life, as far as like on skateboards and surfboards and rails and whatever it is, the kind of tippy balance sort of thing. And I can never quite understand it until now. And the key to this balance I found is my hands, putting my hands together and then moving the hands and arms in synchronicity, either forward or backwards. You put them either forward or, if you want to, between your legs. So you need to sort of crouch down a little bit. And if you're leaning too far forward, you put your arms between your legs a bit. And if you're falling backwards, you put them out in front of you. But to keep them together, don't be flailing the arms separately. The mistake I was making, for instance, in surfing, I wasn't I was a lousy surfer, really. I wasn't, compared to the guys that are good, I was lousy. I mean, I could get out there and do it, but not really what the guys that were on the really nice waves and just carving them up and just, you know, surfing the way you want to surf, because I didn't quite have the awareness and the balance. My eyesight was terrible, which didn't help. There's something to you have to be able to keep your balance really under extreme situations. And you see the people flailing their arms around and starting to lose the balance, oh, you know they're going to fall. So you have to, from the very beginning, understand what you're doing and be very determined. I read this article by someone who caught this wave at, it's called Jaws in Hawaii. And he caught this amazing wave. And he talked through it and what happened. And he said, wow, I just was just so scared. It was one of those days where I just felt I was just determined not to fall no matter what. No matter what, I was just not going to fall. And he talks about how it's a, you know, it's a mind thing and the determination and to keep your balance no matter what. It's really quite extraordinary. And it's really to the point of non-duality. It's a determination to keep our non-dual, non-balance no matter what. Even non-balance is balance. You see, this is non-duality. Even non-balance is perfect balance. So I've been watching this wave, the ride he has. It's amazing. Takes off, the lip suddenly throws out and tries to suck him up. And he's just hovering in the air on the precipice. And then somehow he's able to go forward at the last second. And then he starts dropping like an elevator. But somehow he's able to make contact with the wave and not wipe out there and make it to the bottom. And then he turns and then it just sees this wall closing out. And it just says, okay, I'm going to set my line. And the lip is like drilling him. Huge wave. And he manages to tuck inside it. And it comes after him again. And he disappears. It's like he was on the edge of disaster the whole time. And he had to make these split-second decisions of what to do. And he came out of it. And when he came out of it, he threw up his arms on the board and was just screaming. And it was just like amazement. And then he just collapsed back into the ocean. Just like, he was just absolutely out of his mind with like, wow. And so what we're getting at here is even imbalance is perfect balance. This is the teaching, Longchenpa, the great non-dual teachers. They're pointing to this. And I'm like, oh my God, can I make it? I see this section coming up. Can I make it? And there was a way to make it. And it's just the determination is that I'm not going to fall no matter what. I'm not coming off that board. So when you're on a balance beam, you have to be determined that you are just not going to fall. And as soon as we say, okay, I've had enough, I've done enough, great job. As soon as I release that focus from my mind, I fall. Very interesting. So it really takes a concentration. But even non-concentration is concentration. In other words, we can't fall. How can we fall out of pure spaciousness? So even falling is not falling. Even the abyss is not the abyss. All abyss is now. So it's a shift of perspective here. It's like taking a line, a certain line. You got to take the high road. In this way, we took the high road, the high line. So I better take the high line here. And it worked. So we have a new toy here. This is very great. And like the song says, you'll probably wipe out when you first try to shoot the curve. Grab your board and go sidewalk surfing with me. Well, who didn't, when they got their first skateboard or roller skates, you know, who didn't wipe out a few times or many times? But they said, huh, I wonder, this looks fun. How do I do this without wiping out? So even yoga girls are now. That's right, even yoga girls are now. So, getting to this new toys, how does it feel? Well, I'm enjoying it. So, okay, taking it easy, enjoying it, look and see what, you know, what can we do with this? And I'm just allowing it to play in the mind. Allow the mind to be amused by this new perspective. And be cognizant of the wow. Even mothers are now. Even dogs are now. There's the stores that they say dog friendly, a big sign, dog. So everybody now takes their dogs into the store. Everybody, you see how fast it collapses? It used to be only guide dogs, and then they relaxed it to you have to have the dog be able to carry it, little chihuahuas. Okay, now all dogs welcome. Well, what about people who don't like that? Well, they're out of luck, right? Every time I go into a store now, there's some dog coming up to me, you know, sniffing and stuff. I don't need that. If I want to have a dog, I'll have a dog. But people who have dogs just assume that everybody loves dogs. Not true. We don't love to have dogs in the stores. We love dogs, but not everywhere. But they can't imagine. They cannot imagine that. So even dog lovers are now. I don't know if this is a worldwide phenomenon or just but it may be. It may be. They use dogs to stay grounded in worldly ambition. But even worldly ambition is true. Everything is true. Even yoga girls are true. Even dog lovers are true. Even compoundment is true. Even compoundment is now. All compoundment. All uncompoundment. Samsara, belief in compoundment, is now. Nirvana is now. And there's no difference between samsara and nirvana in relation to now, into to truth, to pure spaciousness. So the wow is starting to build up a little bit, so I'm not quite as eloquent on it as before, but that's expected. That's the price that we pay. Is we don't have uninterrupted eloquence in rehabilitation. We're all rehabilitating from the addiction to dualistic belief in good and bad. In belief in duality and non-duality. No, even non-dual. I mean, even duality is non-dual. Okay, even duality is non-dual. Even duality is now. So this is bringing the wow. Now I can feel it. It's building up. The waves are building up. The waves of wow. Even duality is non-dual. So just full stop in the wow here. This is why this path works so well. It enables us to reach these highest profundities. And we know we're going to get shocked by it. But we say, that's great, we're used to that, and we know how to full stop in the wow. So everything's fine. Everything's normal. See, this is normal. I'm sitting here, and I'm in this state of shock. But I expected that. Used to it, expect to say, okay. I'm almost speechless, and I don't feel like digging anymore at this point. It's like you're digging and you find this, you strike the mother lode, this gold mine. I'm just like, wow. I just uncovered this massive amount of gold. So at that point, you stop digging for a little while. You sort of sit down and just have a bite to eat. Say, okay, wow, I expected it. I can do it, I will do it, I've already done it. I can do this, I will do this, I've already done it. Try this practice to really smooth things out. I can do this. I will do this. I have already done this. And so there is a little trembling, deep trembling. I can feel it in my breath. Shaken up. Is there an inner feeling of really being shaken up? The entire landscape has, of what to be eloquent about, has been shaken up. And so the mind is temporarily shifting from one eloquence to another. And it's temporarily somewhat at a loss for words. So this is why we have to respect one another's silence and not demand words, 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 explanations, explanations, explanations. We have to have faith in the inner teacher that we will be given the explanation when we're ready. This is what happened to me. I just had an inner dialogue. And this on the heels of putting together these Ramana Maharshi slideshows, which I find are extremely profound. Reading some Longchenpa, reading some A Course in Miracles, going through study as much as I can yesterday, and then this morning, okay, picking up and say, let me see where I'm at. And this dialogue has begun arising and has now developed into this. And so temporarily I feel a little out of sorts in terms of dynamic eloquence and presentation and all that. That's fine. This is part of the rehab, is to accept that. There are many who feel they always have to be on stage. But here we say our lines on stage and then we get off stage and we say, wow, that was really intense. We don't just stay on stage all the time when we're going through this rehab. It's rehab for dualistic belief, of thinking that we have to get rid of it. Something has to be defeated. Even defeat is now. Even the defeat of now is now. If we want to practice in that way. Even all insanity is now. All insanity is true. So this is the shifting into the highest echelon of teaching here. This is what Longchenpa brings. This is what he's inviting us towards. Even non-practice is perfect practice. All practice is perfect practice. All practice is perfect practice. Even non-practice is perfect practice. So this has given me like a pin to the seat feeling, which is great. This is what we're after every day. This is rehab. You must use every day to get to this pin to the seat feeling of wow. And if you just do that every day, you will get to ultimately what you want to get to. You will get to the perspective you want to get to. Ultimately, you will. And it won't be delayed too long either. You will wish that it's faster, but you will also feel like that you're going pretty fast. A lot faster than if you weren't doing this, that is for sure. So this ranks right up there with the most profound wows ever. But I've had many, 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 many instances of this. So many, many. So it's not more, really. It's just very strong. It's like a big wave. Powerful big wave. But I'm so used to surfing these big, powerful waves that I say, well, here's another one. Okay. It may be a little bigger, more powerful, but I'm able to handle it better, so that it evens out that way, evens out. So don't be scared about that. By the time you get to a shift like this in perspective, you will already be very confident at riding all other types of waves of wow waves. You'll already be very skilled, big wow surfer. And you'll enjoy it. You'll enjoy riding this wave. You say, I like this. I like the power of this wave. This is really forming up great. This seems like the kind of waves I should be surfing. You know, this seems like finally matching my talent level. Right? Yeah, I wanted a challenge like this. I want something that will bring my talent out. All right, so now, continuing on with this most fortuitous morning. Yeah, this building, I see urgent care. Yeah, urgent care. We need urgent care for sure. We need those who can talk this talk so that there are those who can hear it. Because there are those who are desperate to hear this. Because it matches their talent level, doesn't it? It actually matches all our talent level. We've been trying to dumb ourselves down. And we're struggling so much, I would say, oh, I don't know. Give me something that really shows my talents. So this does. But those who are not familiar with it will be in the shock of the wow. And so somebody has to be eloquent about it. There have to be those who are eloquent about it to help speed it up. Speed it up. Urgent care. All practice is in the now. Already in the now. It's all in the now. Greater than God is in the now. Even greater than God is in the in truth. Even greater than God is in pure spaciousness. Intrinsically, spontaneously so. Effortlessly so. Unavoidably, effortlessly so. Reach a plateau. You have to keep going. You may rest a little bit, but then just say, okay, you got it. I got this habit. I'll continue to keep practicing here. Same with like working out. I've reached this plateau and I'm just not pushing things, but I was pushing things to the extent where I felt really tired. I went through this phase of feeling extremely tired, but that was also mentally going through the shock of realizing I had to make this shift and the anticipation of the trouble I might have in doing this. This was producing a great strain on me, and so I felt very physically tired too, and so I backed off the intense running, and I ran on Sunday quite a bit and was real sore, and I backed off a little, but I stretched this morning, did some jump rope, did some golf swings, did some weight work a little bit, just, feel like, oh yeah, I can still do it. I've just been really exhausted from the intensity, the urgency of these times. It is really pressing this, really pushing us, one way or the other, right? Like pressure says, one way or another, I'm going to get you. It's going to push us one way or the other. For sure. So I realized I was still coming up short. And I caught a glimpse of true being, of beingness, just beingness. Even false beingness is true beingness. And so I've needed to kind of equip myself with some sort of eloquence to relay this and to share it. And so I've been working on this. And there's sort of a lag there where I'm just kind of struggling and not quite sure what to say. And now it's starting to come through. And my my golf swing, it was good. And I haven't been feeling any sense of power in the swing. And I realized you step up to the ball, you hit the driver, you got to feel a sense of power. You have to power the ball. You really have to feel it. And if you're not feeling it, then you're going to try and compensate in all sorts of ways and fake it. And it doesn't work. You have to feel empowered in a certain way. And this is going to go a long way. And your mental focus and feeling of that is really important. And so I worked some things out this morning, and the swing got real good, real good. I said, wow, where's that swing been the last couple of weeks, you know? Well, I've been feeling a bit shaken by the pressure that we're all under. I'm under maybe more pressure because I'm supposed to help everyone with this pressure. That's my job. That's what I'm suited for. That's what I'm calibrated for. So I've got to be ready ahead of the game here. I have to anticipate the troubles that are going to come and be ready for them. So I put myself through this shock and difficulty so I can, you know, bounce back from it. Kind of like homeopathic medicine. You get a little trace amounts of this, trace amounts of that. It's there's probably something to that. It's sort of a corollary to the spiritual path in a certain way, to the body. It's upside down and backwards, but you can see a reflection, even though it's upside down reflection, of get shocked a little bit. This wow, positive shock, and then you get stronger. You get stronger, and you bounce back from it, and it's no longer shocking to you. Because the world's going to become very shocking to the inhabitants of the world. It's already very shocking, actually. When you get your credit card stolen, or you get your debit card stolen, that's pretty shocking. Right now, I don't have a debit card. We're sending you one. Except, but I don't have any money. I don't have it's just like cash. What? Maybe I should get some cash. I don't have anything in my wallet, really. It's like, wow, what is this brave new world that we're going into, really? It's for only for the very brave, or very, I would say, foolhardy. Those who want to live on the edge of a precipice, as if this is somehow going to empower a separate reality. But they're working on empowering it. But even empowering a separate reality is right now, is now. Even that is true. Everything is true. There's only truth. This is the message of A Course in Miracles. Although Jesus, he says, look, I have to talk with you, start out with you where you're at. And so the Course is sort of progressive. It starts out and it gets our attention and it helps us. So he'll say, well, only truth is true and nothing else is true. That's right. So even lies are true. All is true. But the lies being true is not some other truth being true. Okay? There's not some other truth being true. And the trouble we have with lies is we think that's some other truth being true. No. That's just the one truth being true. The one freedom being free. There's not some other one freedom being free. Okay, this is very key. There's not some other nowness being now. Even other nowness being now is now, the one now. There's only the one You hear the teacher say there's only the one, and they keep saying that, and you say, what are they talking about? But for them, this is crucial. They keep saying this because this keeps them, this is a crucial reminder for them. And they have to make sure that they don't slip into duality or into default, right? I mean, in this world, the temptation is very strong. So you hear a lot, there's only the one, there's only the one, right? And there's not some other only the one. That some other only the one is also only the one. And we go, oh. But I get it now. I mean, I get it. It's, I'm getting comfortable with that. Whereas before, I just was not comfortable with this. Understandably so, right? You cannot force it. You have faith that what the teachers tell you is they say, we are sure, I am sure you're going to get there. Ramana Maharshi told me, he said, I'm positive you are going to get there. He said, what the realization I have, you're going to have the same realization. You're going to get there, no doubt. He was adamant about it. He says, I can already see it. I already know it. He says, you're going to get there. So don't give up. Struggle with this. Don't struggle with it. By all means, don't struggle with it. Just say, someday, I'm going to see this. So this is what I'm going to see ultimately. Wow. And someone else has seen this, and Ramana Maharshi was right. There's someone else that's seen it. A knucklehead just like me. So a slowpoke just like me has finally seen this, you know. Wow, there's hope for me. Somebody needs me. But don't struggle. We can always put in an effort to get to a wow, a profound wow, without struggling. Always. And we can tell the difference between when we're just absolutely mentally struggling, or if frustration and lashing out is building up, you can feel that. So don't struggle with it. You don't need to. I just kept the practice going. That's all I've done. Full stop in the wow practice. Just keep it going. Every day. What is my practice? My practice is called everyday practice. That's the name of the practice, really, everyday practice. Walking together in the wow every day. Every day, walking in the wow every day. That's my practice. That's it. I mean, inner dialogue is easy. I mean, anyone could do it. But you're going to get to a wow when you do that. And then what do you do, right? So that's the key to the practice, is again managing our success. Anyone can have success. It's just that we don't take this extra step of managing our success. This is the difference, I would say. That for me, this is the key difference, is I've always been willing to take that extra step. But everyone else has quit. Practicing basketball, friends, everyone says, that's enough, man, quit. I would say, well, okay, let me see if I have another second wind or third or fourth wind here. And I'm willing to put in a little extra effort. And then I'll be out there for another hour shooting baskets. And then I'll get ready to quit. And then maybe, no, let me just do 10 more minutes. Okay. And so I was always, whatever I was practicing or doing, I was always willing to do extra effort. It's 2 in the morning, but I don't feel I've quite finished it off. Like last night, I was up to, I think, almost 1 o'clock in the morning, finishing off the slideshow. Took a lot of work. I said, I just don't want to go to bed until I get this done. I want it done. I want to finish this. So this is the key characteristic. And if you have this characteristic, then by all means, you have the key to success, because use this characteristic to manage your success, because you need that extra concern or love. You have to, Ron Maharshi said, you have to love truth to be liberate, to truly be liberated from fault, from delusion. You have to really love truth. And when you really love something, you will give it this extra effort, extra time, extra attention. And this is exactly what is required. And this is the difference. You know, the dilettantes never succeed because they say, well, I put in, a half an hour and I got some other stuff to do. Whereas the other ones say, well, I haven't got to the wow yet, or I've gotten to it, but now I need to put at least another, half an hour in, get used to that. And then after that, they say, well, I need to also put a little more effort into smoothing this out and catching my breath before I go into the next wow. And I got to set that and get my determination set. And so there's more attention applied to it. And that's the difference. That's the difference maker. So again, it's easy to tell if you have that. But not in a robotic way. So I mean, when you genuinely feel like, wow, I've given it everything I've got here. And then you say, well, okay, but let me just make sure that I really have given everything I've got, and make sure that I really, really put the icing on the cake here, and it's just so. And we're not talking about being a perfectionist or a meticulous. No. It's you're going for the essence of it. Have you got the wow? Okay. Have you full stopped in the wow? Have you allowed it to smooth out? Are you feeling okay to go forward? Are you feeling? Have you got your confidence back? Some back? Are you able? Are you going to be careful as you go forward? Are you willing to carry your confidence through, even though you've been temporarily shaken? Are you willing to spend some time not being eloquent and feeling shaken and not being a star? Are you willing to be quiet for a while? Are you willing to get your rest? Are you willing to see? In other words, are you willing to manage the path? It requires extra effort. Anybody can just throw out practicing. Okay, that's not it. It's the extra effort of managing the success of the practicing. That's where the real work is. takes place. So that's why I say the yoga girls could do all this stuff, that mentality. Okay, but that's not where it's at. That's not where the real work takes place. That's superficial. That's not a real love of truth. It's a love of ambition. Thinking we can create a separate truth. And that's where the attention of the world is on. That's what they love. So they give that extra attention. So you could have two people. Maybe one person's practicing better than the other. They say, wow, what a great practicer I am. It's the tortoise and the hare thing. It's very, very key. And you have someone else who might practice okay, they do pretty good. And the one who's practiced really great, they say, okay, I've done that. I just really knocked that out of the park. And they go off the merry way. And the other one says, wow, you know, I practiced pretty well. And I got this really strong wave of wow going here. And I just need to really stay focused on this because this really, my whole landscape is changing. It's really knocking me out. So I'm going to keep stick with this and just keep my attention on this. And I'm struggling. I got to make careful I don't struggle. So I'm kind of going to feel like maybe people think I'm kind of down and really didn't have a very good practice. So I have to be humble enough to I had that experience happen yesterday. I was really hit so hard by all this. You know, people said, "Hey, how you doing?" And I said, "Well, you know, I wasn't my usual, you know, very super positive self because I go up and down a little bit." And I was just in such a strong wow, I couldn't really emote very much. So really, I felt kind of glum about that. But I said, "It's okay. You got to handle that too." So all sorts of humility arises, you know, and you have to deal with all of that. So there's so many things that you have to deal with effectively in order to get to the next wow, deeper. So these ones who can come in, just knock out the practice, and then they go running off, you know, look at me, man, I'm telling you, the yoga thing, I'm just blasting it. You know, they may just get stuck in just doing that same practice over and over and over and say, look how good I am at this. It's like a one-trick pony, like a piano player who can master certain songs and they just can play that song beautifully, but they never go on to learning, you know, the more involved songs and really gaining a full capability at the piano. Having true flexibility, true depth, you know, true understanding, true realization. They don't go there. So the tortoise and hare, you got to be the tortoise in terms of seeming to like go a little slowly. You know, like, wow, I'm not really quite as quick as the hare. And the hare's jumping around. The hare says, okay, I did my practice. Okay, now I'm really good at that. And let me go on to the next. I'm gonna be a world beater here. And let me go pursue my ambition now. This is not the spiritual path, actually. This is still worldly ambition. It's saying, I can have my cake and eat it too. I can pursue worldly ambition and also knock out these practices, you know. It's not going to affect me. Well, it's going to affect recognition that all worldly ambition is also now. It's most certainly going to cloud that recognition. So there's this intense cloudiness, mental cloudiness in the world that arises from not taking the spiritual path. But doing it superficially. And so much of spirituality in the world now is very superficial. I call it the yoga girl trap. And they look at the mirror and they say, well, I look great. Look great. It's working for me. Everything's working great. I feel very ambitious. I feel very ambitious. I feel I'm able to pursue my ambition. I'm able to keep my balance pursuing it. So everything's fine. It's all working for me. But the ultimate realization is clouded over. And they don't look at that. They don't look at it. They ignore it. I say, well, that's not our problem. I'll get someone else to deal with that problem. And then they try to use people to deal with that, quote unquote, deal with that problem. But even that problem is now. See, there's no problem to deal with. And this is what duality cannot see. They can ignore what they see as a problem, but they're not able to see that there isn't actually any problem at all. There's never been. Because they're trying to create a new reality. That's what ambition is aiming towards. What else could it aim towards? Ambition. So they say, well, yeah, there's no problem. And then this, and on the other hand, they say, yeah, I need you to fix this. Wait a minute, you just said there's no problem. What they mean is, there's a problem, but it's not my problem, it's your problem. That's dualistic. What I'm saying is there isn't any problem, so there's no problem for anyone. Very different. It's not just wordplay. It's an entirely different perspective. It's truly the non-dual perspective. Getting back to a Course in Miracles. Keep in mind that Jesus did say and emphasize over and over, super important, this is a course for the teachers of God. And who's a teacher of God? Anyone who decides to be so. But that's what it's for. It's for those who are going to be teachers of God, helping them towards that. Helping them towards that. It is not, he said, this is not a course to be mastered or learned. Very important. So, he puts these caveats in there that I certainly picked up on. And I understood it. It's not to become another quote-unquote religion. It's to help the teachers of God quickly reach their goal. However they reach the goal, it doesn't matter. It's just we're under pressure to reach the goal. So I'm not confused by it. And so there's no trouble with it, because it's not for those who don't want to be teachers of God, who want to follow, you know, the ambition to separate from God. It's not for them anyway. So it doesn't matter what they say about it or what their confusion is about it. Like say, well, I need, the yoga girl might say, well, I need to learn this because I want it part of my resume. Say, oh yeah, I took a Course in Miracles for a year. You know, pad the resume so people will listen and follow them. It's not for that. It's not for that. Never has been. Never will be. You don't take a Course in Miracles. You don't take it like a course. You immerse yourself in it. And surrender to the immersion in it, and as part of this overall all-out effort to get through this. Well, I don't have a problem. I don't have a problem, but you do, kind of thing. And so you need to fix my problem. There's a problem, but it's not my problem. It's your problem to fix it. You know, that is what we want. We need to get free of this deceit. That's why the video, I will not be a scapegoat for failed ambition. When the ambition fails, they say, well, that's not my problem. No, they say, ambition didn't fail. There's just this problem that arose. from it not working, but you're gonna fix that problem because we're gonna punish you because you blocked it from being successful. So always, ambition needs a scapegoat. That's why they crucified Jesus. They said, if we just get a perfect scapegoat, it'll work for us. If we just get a perfect scapegoat, this is what they believed. Jesus pointed this out to them, said, okay, this is what you believe. I just allowed you to see it. I showcased it for you. But they doubled down on it, which is what you expect, doubled down on religion about it, instead of really taking it to heart. Have a problem with A Course in Miracles, then there isn't a problem for me. There's not a problem. I choose to be a teacher of God. That's my choice. So the Course is for me, designed for me, and I don't have a problem with it. So that's the end of the discussion, really. It's not, well, how do you explain this course to those who don't want to be teachers of God? Well, it's not for them. So there's not, that's the explanation. So there's not, it's not a problem. It's not an issue that we need to talk about. You see, being the teacher of some other God is not a teacher of God. It's not. Or we could say it's all being a teacher of God. There's only being the teacher of God, but there's not some other only being the teacher of God. Not that this will stop anyone from continuing what they're doing, but it certainly will help those who want to really clarify and be clear about all this. Of why isn't it that we can help others? Why can't they? Because they think they are doing. There's this cloudiness, which is taken to be just, well, that's just how it is. And that no one, that's just questioning that is ridiculous. They see it as a ridiculousness, but it's not. They see us as inherently incapable of viewing it from the non-dual perspective, which is not true. And they say, well, there's so few could do that, it's not really worth even talking about, which is temporarily maybe a measurement, a temporary, but it's a short-term measurement that is not really valid in a bigger picture measurement. Okay, so you got a wrong sort of measuring stick. So they seem to be reaching more people. People are listening to them. And they say, look, this is what teaching's about, is look at the response. But they're hiding the downside of all of it. And thinking that doubling down will work, except then they need scapegoats. You know, so the whole thing is self-deception. So we have to concern ourselves with those who really want liberation from this horrible self-delusion. That self-delusion isn't also now. Okay, that's the delusion. That self-delusion isn't also now. It is also now. And it is also true. All is true. There's only truth. And truth is only now. It's just now. All truth is now. And it's all free. It's all expression of freedom. Everything is an expression of freedom. There's nothing that is not an expression of freedom. Even enslavement is an expression of freedom. Perfect expression of freedom. And the bad people are saying, no, you have to see us as bad. Even badness is true. Even badness is now. So duality is very tricky. You just have to realize that it is. It's very slippery. I'm trying to pick up an ice cube. Of course, but when the ice cube melts, there's no slipperiness left. Because even slipperiness is now. Everything melts into the now as flattened out sameness in that regard. And so what we do, we hear this. And it's like someone in a coma. They can't respond, but they can hear. And so I speak knowing that it's being heard. It's just that they're so far, the body, like hypothermia, they're not able to respond properly. They have hypothermia. Their responses are awkward and oftentimes seem nonsensical, but they're hearing it. So if there's any trouble with, any trouble at all with thinking that we can't get through this cloud barrier, we can't see through this, we'll experience that trouble in another lifetime. Okay, if that's the perspective we're going to take, that's just the way it is. You know, we can't do anything about that. We'll have that experience. Experience that if we want to. It's about our lifetime, not this one. So there's no degree to be earned here. It's all a degree. Everything already has its diploma. There's nothing to liberate. As I've said many times, liberation is a realization there's nothing to liberate. And this is the heart of it. Because what we're trying to do in the world, so many is they're saying, no, we're helping liberate from the badness, from the problems. There's nothing to be liberated from. And we say, well, I don't see this. Well, perception, it follows desire, what we want to see, actually. See, we think that perception is primary. It's not. It's secondary. So we have to hear this about perception. Jesus gets into this very clearly in A Course in Miracles about perception. And this is a strong stumbling block we have, because we think, well, look, well, perception's showing me all this stuff. Perception is just an extension of desire. It's not really causative at all. Perception will show you what you want to see. It's like a mirror. It just reflects what you want to see. It's like you say, well, the mirror is showing me this. I can't do anything about it. This is what the mirror is showing me. And it's really like that. Now, the mirror is neutral. It's not showing anything in particular. The mirror has no bias, really. So it's kind of like the world is trying to treat the mirror, trying to do a lot of incantations to the mirror. Say, hey, please, mirror, show me something different. You're really showing me something terrible. We think it's this magic mirror that is showing us this movie, and it's entrancing us. Oh, please, mirror, show me something better. But the mirror is not showing us anything, really, in particular. We're the ones standing in front of the mirror. We're the ones putting stuff in front of the mirror to be reflected. And our desire is what is being reflected in the mirror. And don't struggle with this. Don't struggle with anything that's said. Don't tune it out and don't struggle. Neither one of those extremes. As Buddha said, the middle path is a basic stance in which to hear the truth. Hear it, practice it, everything. You don't struggle with it, nor do you tune it out and get lazy and lax about it. You say, I don't care, I don't really care. You don't struggle, you don't say, I don't care. Yes, I care greatly, but I'm not going to struggle with it. Also, I'm not going to struggle with you. Move forward. Wow. Tough situation here. Gee. There's a card just got around. I mean, these people here are so used to, oh my gosh, they're so used to aggressive driving, it's amazing. Oh my gosh. They just don't stop. They don't care. They're just going to shove their way in when they need to. Amazing, amazing. Chutzpah, you know? Wow. There was this construction zone, and it squeezed us over into an artificial right lane, the two right lanes, and then the construction zone ended, and yet the right lane that we got squeezed into now is a turn-only lane, and so I had to get out of that lane, and so I had to get into the middle lane there immediately. It's like wow. And so I was almost blocking that turn lane because of this. There's no way around this, you know, except there are these cars that just whiz through the turn lane and just kept going straight right through the intersection and then jammed their way in after they got through the intersection. That is chutzpah. Really? They didn't even slow down. Wow. That's the mindset. It's just like, okay, we're entitled to do whatever we want to do. This is an entitlement thing. It's like, I'm entitled to go right through the intersection. I'm entitled to ignore the, you know, ignore the signs and the track, the laws, and I'm entitled to do this. You got to let me in. I'm entitled to just jam my way in here now. It's okay. I mean, that's one way to do it. I mean, it's understandable because it's a very tricky thing there. Although they could have just waited for the traffic light, and you know, signaled and gotten over the right way. That is a strong option right there. Even stress is relaxation. Even mistakes are perfect. open stress is wide open relaxation. Well, this is what we need to hear, actually. This is what we don't hear enough of. There are not enough willing to speak like this. We need more, really, you can really say what needs to be said. Even suffering is bliss. Absolutely. The teachers tell us it's just our attitude towards it that brings about the feeling. For instance, pain, suffering, all this stuff. That is actually just all bliss. It's all truth. It's all now. All suffering too is also now. And now is bliss. Now, as we are walking through this door, we have this wow feeling, and we have a little bit of nervousness, and we think, well, we got to keep proving, let others know that we're still really messed up, really having difficulties, even though we're not, you see. And that's what I did. I messed up, a little mistake. Made a little mistake. We out of nervousness. It's like, oh my gosh, I need to. So, great. I already made a mistake. All mistakes are perfect, too. All mistakes are now also. All mistakes are now also. Mistakes are also now. All mistakes are also now. Got to get in here, son. Now, in terms of functioning, when you're in this tremendous well, just keep it low-key. Keep it normal, but just keep it low-key. Don't try to stand out in any way. Just be very lowly, if possible. As much as possible. I'm going to see how I can get through the rest of the day. So let me get going, working on that. Wow, it's very intense. It's very, very strong. And my psychological equilibrium is, of course, shifting. And so when you do that, you know, you're just, you're not neither here nor there kind of feeling, neither here nor there. So you just accept it, neither here nor there. And I can, I will, I already have, and look forward to the new landscape and enjoying that. All right. All right, we're off and running again. This guy just got some great, great news. Terrific news. Wonderful news. So, very helpful. And been interacting with a lot of people still in the wow. I did a lot better this time. I intentionally did not become too exuberant or outgoing. And everybody's very, very nice to me. And everything worked out much more smoothly. So, try to keep yourself, when the highs are high, you stay the same. When the lows are low, you stay the same. Like you're in the middle, and you're not going too hot. You're not going with the highs. You're not going with the lows. They're there, but you're not reacting to them. You're staying in the wow. Full stop in the wow. Just in the wow. I say, okay. Now the buzz of the wow is still here. This is, you know, an hour or two later. I didn't get too involved. I spoke some. I got some tips from health tips from somebody, and it was just positive. But I just had a sort of awareness of don't kind of play it low key, kind of low key the whole thing. Trouble is when we're in the wow, we tend to, if we start really trying to interact too much, we tend to go back to what we're used to, familiar with, like taking refuge there. You don't want to do that. You don't want to do that because we're in a phase where we're moving towards something different landscape. You have to allow that to settle in. So don't go back to old patterns of conversation, of what's you know, the way that you used to do it. Just stay kind of quiet and humble. Then again, don't worry if you've forgotten. Like, oh, I forgot. Okay, what was the insight again? No. Don't do that. That's why you don't want to be explaining to anybody. Very important not to try and explain directly, socially, anything. I can tape like this a little bit. Have to be careful. But you don't have to explain to anyone. Don't tell anyone, oh, I just had this great insight. I got to explain it to you. How do I explain this? Oh, really? Well, how could you explain it to... That's the worst. That is the worst. Okay. This is why they have people in monasteries. Okay. Where... you have these breakthroughs and you don't have to explain to anyone. Turn your troubles into blessings. Turn your troubles into blessings. For the last year I've had this trouble structurally with my shoulder, but it's required me to start exercising, see what can I do. So a number of things that I've had have gotten me into a situation where I'm now aware of what I need to do to get in better shape. And it's been a blessing in disguise, because it's real easy to coast into older age, to coast into it. And if you have the money to go places and you eat a lot of food, you know, you're just living kind of a good life. Wow, you're before you know it, suddenly your body is just, it's too late for you. And now, for me, it's like a second life I'm having. But I realize I can't let it slide anymore. And so this is, it's like a sort of a, almost like a second life of, I need to get stronger. I need to get in better shape. I need to do this. I need to do that. I got to. And so I'm motivated to do it. Pretty amazing. We have to look at our life as a blessing. Whatever is going on is a blessing, and make, like I say, make lemonade out of the lemons. Really nice lemonade. I could use some lemonade. Maybe I'll start doing that. That sounds really good, actually. Yeah. I'm gonna start making some lemonade. Lemonade. So take it easy on yourself. Someone was just talking to me how he doesn't have a commute. It's so easy. He's right by the freeway. Just jumps on the freeway. It's so easy for him. And he says, when I have to move, it's going to be so difficult. And I said, no. I said, wait a minute. I said, maybe your life was just meant to be easy. You know, maybe you're, and he laughed. Oh, thank you. And it was like, it was kind of an interesting thing to say. But I've said, take it easy on ourselves. Let's take it easy. Take it easy on ourselves now. Seriously easy. Let really, really great situations arise for us. I've always tried to take it really difficult on myself. Super difficult. It's a big change to take it easy, but that doesn't mean lazy or indolent or slothful or unfocused. No, it means that the situations we have are helping us focus on the spiritual path and the discipline of it better and better and better. And we're allowing ourselves to be blessed into the true easement of reality, which is perfect easement. Perfect easement. A lot of traffic here, so we can do a lot of taping. That's great. See another lemon here. We make lemonade out of it. And he said, well, when you're driving in all this traffic and you got to do something, he said, turn on a favorite radio station or something. That's what he said. I said back to him, or something. Yeah, I didn't say I'm taping, but it's a great way to spend the commute. I mean, I used to waste the commute. I was so upset. I said, well, I have to do something. This is ridiculous. We spend 3 hours a day in commute. For me, I drive a lot. Just so much driving time. And we're just listening to some stupid radio station. I mean, this is dumb. This is why I say use your smartphones to tape. There's a tape recorder function on your smartphones. I mean, if you're going to have a smartphone, use it smartly. Don't let technology just tell you how you're supposed to use it. You could be taping. You could be taping. Set it up and it's a holder here. Put on record and you tape like you're preparing to be a teacher of God. While you're commuting. It's almost like forced meditation. I love it. I love it. So I'm not all like flustered and upset and angry with the traffic. I say, I love it. This enables me to engage in this wonderful meditation here. It's a blessing from God. Again, the monasteries, you're in there. You have the wow. You can be quiet. In fact, you're supposed to be quiet. And that's very helpful. It's not some kind of forced silence on everyone. You might see if you can do it for a year or anything like that. No, you just the quiet is the norm. It's okay. It's good because people there are having breakthroughs. They're having success. They're having breakthroughs. They have to manage their success. Silence is a great help for that. Not having to socially explain is super helpful. So if you're not in a monastic situation, you have to manage it very carefully. don't. I used to talk about my path and try to explain to people, and it absolutely caused me the worst problems. Way, way better to really focus your attention on the wow and full stop in the wow. Way more helpful. New homes everywhere. Just like mushrooms. The traffic will only get worse here unless there's a big kabloom, financial bubble bursts, which it certainly could. We don't know. We really don't know what's going on in the deeper echelons of criminality and cyber warfare and cyber control and speculators and all this stuff. I mean, it's just, we just don't know. Intuitively, we could know, but superficially, it's not like it used to be, right? This used to be cash on the gold standard, and that's it. Pretty simple. The good old days, financially. We'll let them sort that all out, but we're not going to be part of all that troubles. And constantly, they want to change the entire monetary economic system of this world. Nobody left behind. I do know the United Nations at the highest level, and the backing of very powerful interests, do have these sustainable development goals, and they have this blueprint to the year 2030, and they absolutely have very detailed blueprint on how they expect the world to go. But they're using all the leverage and power they have to move it that direction. And they have, again, a plan to monitor everyone, United Nations, all the way down to the grassroots level of reporting how we're going towards these goals. And as I pointed out before, they have an agenda, big time, extremely feminist-oriented. They've talked about the goddess, how she's inspiring Mother Earth, and they talked about this vision they have for this Mother Earth, and empowering women, and just, but really, it's putting women in charge. It's very transparent what they're about. And this is the whole yoga girl thing. What they're planning for is that trend is going to converge with the United Nations trend, their agenda. There's all these agendas converging, and we don't realize how set in stone it is, actually. And how this agenda is actually dualistic, very dualistic, but sold to the world as a spiritual agenda. Okay. This is selling false hope to everyone. And with selling false hope, you need scapegoats. And so they already have the scapegoats lined up. Of course they do. That's why I say to all the scapegoats, sidestep all this, bypass it. Say, no, thanks, but no thanks. Don't be a scapegoat with a crown on your head and a gilded cage. Forget it. about the perks. What good is that? You know, when they set someone up for a scapegoat, they fet them royally, you know, and give them all this royal treatment. The better to empower the sacrifice, okay? In their minds. Sacrifice is all just magical belief. So, don't go for that. You absolutely can, through right discipline on the spiritual path of just full stop in the wow. That's all you really need to practice. And a few little techniques are helpful with assertions too to speed things along. But just by that discipline, the clarification will arise in your mind. The inner teacher is already there. And you will be able to gradually glimpse and then get familiar with clearer and clearer, clearer clarifications and explanations and recognitions. And ultimately get to this non-dual perspective. All without being any scapegoat. Don't have to be a scapegoat. Do not have to be a scapegoat. That really doesn't help at all. It makes things worse. Been in the teeth of the Bay Area commute here for half an hour. And it could have us, you know, 45 to another, I don't know, an hour maybe to go. If we're fortunate. And got real, real drowsy. Just hit real strong. And I almost hit the car in front of me, right? I mean, just like, because you're going along, everyone's going along, and then just suddenly it just stops. It's real tricky traffic here. No rhyme or reason. And you rarely expect to completely stop on the freeway. So you're going along and you think everything's fine, and then a complete stop, that's when the trouble is. So I had to have an emergency little can of Coca-Cola, 8 ounces, I think. And I poured that into my chocolate and blueberry and strawberry smoothie. Chocolate protein drink with frozen strawberries and blueberries. Put that little 8-ounce can of Coke in there, mixed it all up, and it was delicious. It was delicious. So, it was psychological more than anything. It just sort of really focused me on handling this traffic. And another little trick I'm doing now, to be safer here, remember the code word is to be very, very conservative, play it safe, and very conservatively right now in your life, and take it easy on yourself. So, I didn't want to battle with this terrible drowsiness all the way home for another hour in this dangerous traffic. So I said, okay, all right, let me get a little help here. Maybe just take the slight edge off of this drowsiness. And what I'm doing is I'm downshifting. That's right, I am downshifting. Right now I'm in second gear. This helps a lot. Because when you're coasting, it's like a governor on it slows you down. And you're not liable to just be gliding into the car in front of you. I could even try first gear if it gets real slow. So the speed up, it doesn't happen so easily at all. I will try first gear. That's real low. Now this is a trick I've not really tried before. This sort of traffic. But it seems to be working well. The way vehicles are geared now, when you're in drive, the car really tends to go. And it picks up speed quickly. You don't want that. Plus, I'm leaving a gap between me and the car in front, quite a gap. Which is another, playing it safe, play it conservatively. In all ways in your life. So it's in second gear. Now it's starting to move a little. It's like 30 right now. That's about tops for second gear. Now it's moving a little quicker, the traffic. But I'm keeping it in second gear. Which, when you take the foot off the accelerator, it really slows down quickly, naturally. Leaving a lot of space here. I think people are starting to learn that. They're doing that more. You just cannot be up on the cars in front of you. It's too dangerous. We're all so used to going fast, trying to, that nobody wants to stop or slow down in this Silicon Valley. So it's not too bad, this route. The other route is actually worse. This one is eased up. The route I'm on now is eased up this year. It used to be terrible. Not so bad right now. Put it in third gear. Shift to third. It's just a great helper, actually. And it also keeps you engaged with the traffic. So, we don't go off in a reverie and start daydreaming and thinking of this and thinking of that. No, you got to stay engaged in the now, shifting up and down. Big help. When I'm driving, like I'm taking a driving trip, going somewhere, often we'll comment about the cars. Look at that car. I wonder what they're doing. What are they, you know? And just be aware of the cars and their personalities, and what do you think the driver might do? And just stay engaged with the road. And say, oh, that's a nice car. You know, what? Okay. You have to be aware of the people around you. Cannot just go into this. You're thinking about something else. When it's traffic like this, in terms of reverie, do not go off in reverie. Daydreaming, taping helps also. It keeps me right focused, that I have to be mentally sharp. Very helpful. You just don't want to drift off. It can be real subtle too. So now we're stopped here. I'm going to second. I'm gonna try first. This is really gonna slow things down. Oh yeah. Okay, this is for real stop and go. Just crawling along. Which we're doing now is just put it in first gear. And we're doing about 10 miles an hour, 12 miles an hour. Now it speeds up a little, go to second. It's very stressful, this type of, see the traffic was just now, just stopped, came to a grinding halt. So all of this in the context here of this tremendous shift today in the whole inner landscape. And I'm just finding out how can I function with this new orientation. And this rush hour traffic gives a, you know, real good test. A I stayed humble enough to say, you know what? Let's play it safe here. I'm just feeling this drowsiness is could get. You know, I don't want to have any troubles here. So let me get a little help. I could have yesterday. I battled against it, but circumstances were slightly different. You know, suddenly the traffic picks up here, and I'm back into drive, and we're doing, you know, 60 suddenly. But I know it's going to come to a screeching halt up here. You have to anticipate and be aware. It's not, oh, we're just cruising along, thinking about the future, thinking about the past, thinking about what we're going to do, thinking about some movie script in our mind of, oh, this would make a nice movie, you know, the dramas and stuff. No. So, okay, here comes the pinch, traffic-wise. Ready for it. Ready to slow down. Red lights are going on. It's not as bad as yesterday at all. Yesterday was horrible. It's hard to say exactly what causes why some days are worse than others. But here we are. We're now grinding to a close to a halt. Downshift into second. Cars up front look like they have stopped, and they have. I'm going to first, and we are now going 0 miles an hour. Okay, from 60 or 65 going to zero. In just a short space here. This is how it goes. Cannot have inattention here. Cannot. You just cannot let up your attention for an instant. This it's really quite a quite a task. I don't know how people can text in this sort of traffic. Not recommended. You take your eyes off the car in front of you for just a second, too late. Stopped. So this taping is just designed to help us recognize that in the wow, when you're going through an intense wow phase, you just function normally. Keep your focus and be serious about it. Don't be cavalier. Don't say, oh, I'm really so spiritual, you know, I just had such a great spiritual insight. No, don't lose yourself in that at all. Stay grounded in humility. Always stay grounded in humility. This commute here will make you humble. There's no question about it. There's no aggrandizement. Yeah, I mean, we are stopped. I'm behind a 350Z, Nissan 3, beautiful, the Nissan 350Z. And the cars are just going along at a snail's pace now. We've got a long ways to go in this sort of this sort of crawl here. We're just, this is the bad part. Many people are using this gearing trick, because you know, even though we have automatic transmissions, we do have the shift that we can use. There's just no clutch, but we can, you know, it says drive one, drive two, drive two, drive one, whatever it is. I have three. I have drive, three, two, and one. So like when I'm going down a hill, I can put it in like two, or if it's real steep and you have to go slow, one. And it's just like, you know, you don't have to use the brakes hardly at all. This is really helping out a lot, because even when I accelerate, it doesn't go anywhere hardly. It still goes real slow. So what do we say? Make it easy. Make it easy on ourselves. Make it easy on ourselves. Be safe, be conservative, make it easy on ourselves. This is the key for these times right now. So even in a traffic jam like this, we can use it as spiritual meditation, a spiritual practice here of reminding ourselves of what we need to be reminded of. Keep reminding ourselves that this is how habits are formed. See, we're forming new habits of attention here. And habits are not easily formed. They don't, you know, we have to actually keep putting your attention on them. Keep doing it. And again, don't try to attack bad habits. Put your attention on good habits. And just by lack of attention, the bad habits will die off that way. They won't have the juice anymore. They just won't. You turn to it and you just, I'm not really interested. I don't feel any, you know, pull of attention there. Because I'm too busy focused on good habits. Starting to move a little bit. And of course, that's the dangerous part. Kind of like the wow, you get moving real good and you're making a lot of progress, and then here comes the slowdown suddenly, and you have to be expected that there'll be a slowdown for you. So that's the real spiritual practice, is these waves of progress, followed by, you know, a little slowdown, and be willing to work in that way. It's not this, I'm going to do 3 days of retreat and just crank through it unbelievably, drinking a bunch of tea or coffee or whatever. Just that's not how the path is done. That is not going to bring about the true realization that is there for us. It will not. There's so many retreats being set up around the world now. So many, many, many of these retreats. Enticing us into buying into this. To entice us to buy into this notion that this is how we're running. This is how the yoga girls are running the New World Order spiritual scene. Okay, remember, the New World Order will have a very strong spiritual scene superficially. Very strong. That's to help entice people. Say, don't worry, there's nothing to worry about. In fact, we'll have even more spiritual teaching now than before under the reptilian control. This is all part of the great grand deception. Now, real spirituality is in the home, in the family, in the schools, in everyday life, all about us every day. That is what it's really about. Okay, it is not about these fancy yoga girl retreats. That is not what it's about. So we are really in this grand deception situation now. Take a cruise to the Greek Isles with me. And then we'll have this wonderful meals with those beautiful Greek food and wine. It's delicious. And the sights. And we'll walk on the beach. And it'll just be so awesome, you know. It's like a vacation. Take a spiritual vacation. No, that doesn't get the job done. Prayers before meals in the family talking about each one having an opportunity to talk about their day in light of what kind of spiritual lessons did you learn today for the children. Religious instruction in school about the virtues and self-discipline and kindness and not projecting anger and blame and taking responsibility for your, you know, for your experiencing, and on and on and on and on. Focusing on the saints in school. Absolutely. The focus should be on the great saints and the great victorious ones and the great traditions, and they should have people come from those great traditions and give talks to the kids. There should be icons throughout culture in public places and public spaces and public awareness. It should be saturated with the victorious ones, with the symbology, with the motivation. All of this stuff is required, really. And we've gotten rid of that from our society. The modern world, in many places, is a secular society, and they're kidding themselves and kidding us if they think anyone thinks a secular society is going to have spiritual success. They are dreaming. You know, it's only a few mavericks who will have success, who insist on surrounding themselves like I have. Living on like a monastic life of constantly, my whole life has been, you know, like surrounded by saints, the victorious ones, the pictures, the symbology, the books I read. It's everything I could do is to keep that. But this is just an extreme effort in a horribly secularist society. It's awful. A disgrace is what it really is. Extreme disgrace. What a refreshment when you see a bumper sticker saying, you know, God is love or something like that, or Jesus loves you, or, you know, whatever, anything, an Ohm sticker, or, you know, anybody just putting a reminder on their vehicles, you know, of great God's grace. You might be feeling like you're going down, and suddenly you see, you know, a symbol of God's grace, and you say, oh yeah, right? And it keeps your momentum. It's about momentum. The spiritual path is about everyday effort. And of course, the wow will keep you humble. It's a humble place, an everyday effort place. Well, you have ups and downs, and you need to be helped through those downs. And you do not allow the parasites of sex and drugs and rock and roll and gambling and all this stuff. These are opportunistic parasites that when you're down, when you're going through these ups and downs of the spiritual path, they try to tempt you away and pull you down. And this has been known throughout history. And our culture used to highlight that stuff. And the children were taught that. Look, you see this guy? He's trying to say, hey, why don't you try this drug? You know, it's like, you feel bad? Oh, that's terrible, man. Yeah, I know, life really gets you down, doesn't it? Hey, I got a little something here. It's like amazing pickup, you know. And why don't you try this? He says, you know, it's fun. I tried it. It's no problem. And you'll get a little. And so the drug pushers, they try to hook you on drugs when you're going through the ups and downs and the difficult periods of your life. And it's just unbelievable. And now we're just basically trying to make drugs legal here like this. It is an insane society right now. Plain and simple. And they don't, of course, the insane don't realize that. They don't realize it. And they'll argue with you about it. And I don't have any time to argue with them anymore about it. It's crazy what we have done to secularize our society. We've just made it very, very, very difficult on ourselves. And we're supposed to make it easy on ourselves. And so we have gone down the wrong path. Instead of saying, well, I mean, Christians, I'm happy to see an Om sticker or you know, some symbol, a Rigpa, you know, a sticker. Tibetan Buddhist, you know, any iconography from any religion, I'm delighted to see it. Being ecumenical. I love the Catholic iconic, you know, icons. I love the Protestant. I love the, you know, overall whole Christian thing. I love the Buddhist thing. I love the Hindu thing. And I love all the others too. Whatever it is. Love the reminders. The only thing that's allowed in this culture is the goddess. That's it. She could have as many shrines as the... Yes, she was. It's amazing. Because, of course, she is an icon that says, don't worry, everything is fine here in terms of this culture. Like, you're gonna be happy. You're going to love it. Mother knows best. Listen to what Mother says. And, of course, Mother is controlled by the matrix here, the structure of the secular matrix. Mother is heavily controlled by that. So saying Mother knows best, of course the people who brainwashed Mother want you to believe that. So of course they're going to promote the Mother Goddess. And people say, listen to your mom. She knows best. She knows we're not supposed to pray at the family table. She knows you're not supposed to. She knows you're supposed to watch television. She knows you're supposed to listen to your teacher's secular curriculum. She knows how to put, you know, all this stuff. Of course. That's exactly what they want. And they want the male figures of the past. Most of religious figures in history have been male figures, percentage-wise. And they want that all forgotten. All forgotten. Because their plan is this global bureaucracy of everybody being robots and worshiping it and believing it's absolutely God-given, you know, orders. And they want obedience. What does a bureaucracy want? It wants obedience. Unquestioned obedience is what it wants. It doesn't want people getting out of line. It wants it streamlined. streamlined is what they want. And it's a big task to regulate every single thing that everybody does. They want it streamlined. They want you to be into it, enthusiastic about it, willing to take orders. This is the dream of these bureaucrats, the secular humanists. This is what they strive for. This is what the machines want. And they see great beauty in everyone obeying. An order is given, all society immediately obeys. This is what they really are aiming for. I must answer the phone. I must answer the phone. We have to remind ourselves that there's been a massive war against religious culture in the United States and in Europe too, all around the world. A huge effort to secularize society. Fallout effort. The reptilians don't want any competition. They don't want us invoking the saints, the victorious ones, who were victorious over the reptilians. They're over their ideology, you see, over dualistic ideology. They're victorious over that. So they don't want anyone to even know about that. They don't want the kids to have the slightest idea that there's any victorious ones at all, that anyone can stand up to this reptilian ideology, the dualistic ideology. So they any spiritual thought needs to go through first yoga girls. Okay, that's one of their big jobs that they're doing. If you think about religion at all or spirituality, it has to be female oriented. Now, that's very important. So you forget all about all the great success that men have had throughout history. You're not supposed to even reference that at all. It's sexist to reference that, you see. They want to wipe out any competition to their rule, to their domination here. They want things to run smoothly. They want people to obey them, plain and simple. This shifting and changing of cultures has happened throughout history, of course, and so we're aware of how it works. But now this is on a higher scale as far as the drasticness of it coming, much, much, much more so. But still, the principles are pretty much basically the same. Those who are taking over want the old regime gone. Any trace of it wiped out. I mean, when Constantine decided to make Christianity the official religion of the Roman Empire, they destroyed, you know, all the old religious icons of the pagan Roman paganism, except Madonna and Child of the Isis cult. Except that one. That was the only one that was allowed to remain. Interesting, because again, it's the aristocratic women of Rome insisted upon it. And the powerful men, they didn't want to have to deal with their wives and their daughters, sisters, aunts, mothers, you know, nieces, grandmothers, you know, the entire matrix of feminist power. They said, okay, yeah, we'll leave that one alone. The other ones are not as important to them. So they made a deal there. They made a deal. And so they wipe out, but they wipe out the past. They wipe out the icons of the, you know, the shifting, changing. I think in Egypt, that happened. That was Amenhotep or something. I can't remember his name, but the quote unquote monotheistic pharaoh that just tried to just get rid of, you know, all the old stuff, the icons, everything. And so it just happens over and over and over and over and over again here, and it's really boring. This world is just, it just goes cycling on and on and on. It's so boring. Because everybody thinks it's false hope. How boring is generating false hope? That's incredibly boring. It's only not boring when you don't realize it's false hope. But then you get caught up in the jaws of it. So then it becomes horrible. So this world's either horrible or terribly boring, or both. Unless you recognize the non-dual truth, which then it's neither of those. But there's no world anymore. There's no external world. There's never been an external world, but perception, our desire to see an external world, it seems as though there's an external world. Perception says there's an external world to it, to perception, to our eyes, for instance. They say, well, obviously this world's external to our eyes. But is it external to our mind? Is it external to our mind? Different question, isn't it?